Developing news right now, fireworks on the Hill. NSA Director General Keith Alexander testifying before that House committee. It's just one of the hot topics for today's agenda panel as well. We continue to monitor this hearing. Tegan Goddard is the editor of Political Wire. Judd Legum is the editor-in-chief of Think Progress. Good to see both of you.
Good to be here.
Nice to see you.
Tegan, we were just talking in the green room before the show started, and we were talking a little bit about what we've learned over the course of the past hour or so and what we have not learned. There seems to be a great deal that we still don't know about these two surveillance programs.
That's right. I mean, the details are still very sketchy, but the politics of the situation are really extraordinary. I mean, late last week we had a poll from Pew Research that came out that said that Democrats who opposed these programs during the Bush administration now support them, and Republicans who supported them now oppose them. Now we have situations where lawmakers on Capitol Hill are starting to sort out where they stand on this, and you have Senator Bernie Sanders and Senator Rand Paul agreeing that these programs probably went too far. And then you have President Obama and former Vice President Dick Cheney defending the program. So the politics are really bizarre, and I think that these hearings will at least begin to allow Americans to sort out what they feel about them, but we need more information, and the information really is very sketchy still.
Judd, what do poll numbers like that say about not just the popularity of the programs, but what does it say about our politics as well?
Well, I think clearly people are being moved by partisanship here. We had similar programs during the Bush administration, and they were a lot less popular among Democrats and more popular among Republicans than the programs are today. What really I think is the important thing to keep in mind as we look at this hearing is that we've got a number of people coming up who, as the senator was saying in your last segment, are honorable people. Probably using this really to combat terrorism. But the problem is there's really no effective oversight of these programs. I mean, you have this surveillance court, which is set up. It operates in secret.
Right.
And there's no one on the opposing side. It's just the government presenting their case. It would be as if you had a criminal case, and it would just be the police and the prosecutors making their case, and the defense wouldn't get any side. It's really not a fair fight. As a result, they really don't reject virtually any request.
Judd, Tegan, stand by for me just a second. We want to listen in a little bit more here. This is Sean Joyce being questioned. Sean Joyce, of course, a deputy director of the FBI. Let's listen in and let's talk a little bit more on the other side.
After 9/11 that the FBI conducted, we conducted that investigation and did not find any connection to terrorist activity. Several years later, under the 215 business record provision, the NSA provided us a telephone number only in San Diego that had indirect contact with an extremist outside the United States. We served legal process to identify who was the subscriber to this telephone number. We identified that individual. We were able to, under further investigation and electronic surveillance that we applied specifically for this U.S. person with the FISA court, we were able to identify co-conspirators, and we were able to disrupt this terrorist activity.
I'm sorry, repeat for me again what they were plotting to do.
It was actually, he was providing financial support to an overseas terrorist group that was a designated terrorist group by the United States.
But there was some connection to suicide bombings that they were talking about, correct?
If not in the example that I'm citing right here.
Oh, I'm sorry, the group in Somalia to which he was financing, that's what they do, that's what they do in Somalia, correct?
That is correct. And as you know, as part of our classified hearings regarding the American presence in that area of the world.
Okay. Thank you. Chairman, are you back?
Well, if I could, Congressman, just hit a couple key points. It's over 50 cases. And the reason I'm not giving you specific numbers, we want the rest of the community to actually beat those up and make sure that everything we have there is exactly right. I'd give you the number 50X. But if somebody says, well, not this one, actually what we're finding out is there are more. They said you missed these three or four. So those are being added to the packet. On the top of that packet, we'll have a summary of all of these, the listing of those. I believe those numbers are things that we can make public, that you can use, that we can use. And we'll try to give you the numbers that apply to Europe as well as those that had a nexus in the United States. The issue in terms of releasing more on the specific overseas cases is that it's our concern that in some of those, now going into further details of exactly what we did and how we did it, may prevent us from disrupting a future plot. So that's something that's work in progress. Our intent is to get that to the committee tomorrow for both intel committees, for the Senate and the House.
Great. Thank you.
Mr. Thompson.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you all very much for being here and for your testimony and for your service to our country. Mr. Litt, before going to hearing, does or has the FISA court ever rejected a case that's been brought before it?
I believe the answer to that is yes, but I would defer that to the Deputy Attorney General.
It has happened. It's not often, but it does happen.
Thank you. Mr. Cole, what kinds of records comprise the data collected under the business records provision?
There's a couple of different kinds. The shorthand, and it's required under the statute, is the kinds of records you could get with a grand jury subpoena. These are business records that already exist. It could be a contract. It could be